What's up, everybody? GenX Dividend Investor here. I hope that you and your family and friends are all safe and healthy. Try to stay optimistic and don't give up if things are tough right now. We've had a lot of discussions lately on my Dividend Discord server about when you should sell a dividend stock. I was sharing some of my thoughts on the topic, and a user named Lewis said, GenX, I understand you get a lot of requests, but I'd like a comprehensive video about when you'd sell a stock. So I thought that this video would be useful to do sooner rather than later, as this topic has come up multiple times given our volatile market conditions. Now there are a variety of reasons why I'd sell a stock, and I'll include some reasons why I wouldn't sell. These aren't in any particular order. Number one is obvious, but sometimes people don't mention it. I would sell if I needed the money and didn't have a better way of coming up with the cash. Obviously I would try to find other options rather than sell stock, but if that was the only realistic option at my disposal, then I'd do that. Unexpected real-life things happen all the time, and sometimes they're so impactful that you can't realistically plan or even budget for them. For example, someone you care about might develop a medical condition which requires ongoing bills that far surpass their insurance, assuming they have any. So something like that might influence me to sell stock if I didn't want to utilize some of my spare cash I keep on the side. Or look at what is happening right now in the world, where we are experiencing a global pandemic which isn't something that most people or businesses really plan for and set aside funds for, because it has never happened in modern history. So if you can avoid selling your stocks for expenses, that is ideal, but if you can't because you unexpectedly got laid off and your emergency funds ran dry, then selling stocks might make sense. Number two, I'd also contemplate selling a position if it had gotten too large in my portfolio relative to the overall weighting I was going for. Sometimes I might just let that slide for a while, but if it got too large, then I might trim it in favor of underweight inexpensive other stocks. Normally, I like to keep my positions no larger than 10% of my portfolio, so if a single position was much larger than that, then I would really scrutinize it. Number three, if a company cuts their dividend or failed to raise it, then I'd need to understand what the underlying reasons were behind their actions, and then I'd determine if I'd sell. If something fundamentally negatively changed with the company, such as their future growth potential, then that might influence me to sell. So let's consider an example. If a company I liked, let's say McDonald's, ends up suspending or cutting their dividend while we have this pandemic, would I sell them? No, I probably wouldn't. Why? Because it wasn't McDonald's bad management that caused people not to go to their restaurants, and because I think once we are past this issue, they'll be doing great again. Or let's look at Disney. Would I sell Disney if they cut or suspended their dividend right now? Probably not. Why? Because again, I don't fault Disney for their low park attendance or cruise attendance due to the pandemic. Now, you could argue that their management should have massive reserves that they tap into to pay shareholders so that they can insulate their dividend from events like this, but I'd counter that this is such an unprecedented event, and sitting on that much cash is also wasteful, unless they are someone like Apple who uses it for acquisitions and such. However, if a company I wasn't as convicted in, like my oil companies, cut or suspended their dividend, then I might sell them. I still think there's a lot of money to be made in oil, and we will need it for decades. But I believe that investing in oil is investing into headwinds, so I might use bad dividend news as an opportunity to move my cash into something else. I might wait until oil had recovered to unload it, or I might unload it sooner, depending on a variety of other factors. Speaking of dividend cuts, I've set up a channel on my Discord server which automatically posts dividend cuts and hikes in real time as they are found. What I'm doing is I'm tying it into Twitter accounts of users that post them, so it isn't guaranteed to be accurate, but it has proven to be fairly accurate and useful to get real-time updates into a channel. Beyond understanding the underlying reason for the cut, I would also do things like ask myself if the company was still the 800-pound gorilla in their industry, i.e. are they still the best company in their industry and is the industry still a good one? I'd do things like determine if they still have their competitive moat and do I still see growth potential based on what they're doing and what's happening in the world. I also like to check their financial metrics to see how they're trending and will trend. In times like this, I might ask myself if the government might bail them out and what the implications might be of something like that. For example, if Duke Energy ran into trouble, would they get bailed out? As my grandmother used to say, you can bet your bippy. That means yes. What about someone like AT&T? Would AT&T get help from the government if they were about to go under? Yeah, I think if a primary cellular player couldn't make it, the government would help them out because they're basically a utility that our nation needs to function. The more critical a company they are, the greater odds that they might be helped out. And even though I'm not fond of investing in companies that can't make it on their own, it is another safety net for your investments, which is nice. All of these things I would factor into what I'd do if my company cut or suspended the dividend. As always, it's not black and white. Okay, let's move on. The number four reason why I might sell a stock is if a company does something which fundamentally doesn't align with my values. So for example, if a company's management team is found cooking the books, then I would probably sell them. The number five reason I might sell a stock was if its industry was dying and the company wasn't evolving to my liking. For example, think of what happened to Blockbuster or Kodak. Blockbuster could have killed the young upstart Netflix as it started streaming, but they sat idly by thinking that their brick and mortar model was safe. Kodak could have moved aggressively into the digital world, but they didn't. The number six reason I might sell a stock was if something fundamentally changed with the business that I didn't like, then I'd consider selling. For example, they closed down business lines or they launched into new businesses too aggressively, neglecting old business lines or etc. Things that fundamentally changed why I liked them in the first place. The number seven reason I'd consider selling was if I felt I had made a bad call on my original buy. So maybe I got into something like Reader's Digest, but then I see that they aren't evolving into the digital world and their target demographic just keeps getting older and older and less revenue is getting generated. Well, then I'd probably sell. The number eight reason why I might sell a stock was if I felt there was a much better opportunity out there. I've gotten out of multiple dividend stocks in my history to get into other stocks I felt would have better returns for me and were more aligned to my various needs and goals. The number nine reason why I might sell a stock is due to real life reasons. I'll give you an example of something that might cause me to sell, using Warren Buffett, the ultimate buy and hold investor. In his 2014 annual shareholder letter, he said, "My advice to the trustee could not be more simple. Put 10% of the cash in short-term government bonds and 90% in a very low-cost S&P 500 index fund." I suggest Vanguard's. I believe the trust's long-term results from this policy will be superior to those attained by most investors, whether pension funds, institutions, or individuals who employ high-fee managers. So here's an example of the world's best buy-and-hold investor who is saying to move into inexpensive, broad-market funds like a VTI or VOO once he dies, probably because he feels it's the easiest way for his wife's assets to continue to prosper without him managing them. So unexpected things like that might come up from time to time that might cause me to sell. Speaking of buying and selling stocks, Buffett also said this in that same shareholder letter. "When Charlie and I buy stocks, which we think of as small portions of businesses, our analysis is very similar to that which we use in buying entire businesses. We first have to decide whether we can sensibly estimate an earnings range for 5 years out or more. If the answer is yes, we will buy the stock or business if it sells at a reasonable price in relation to the bottom boundary of our estimate. If, however, we lack the ability to estimate future earnings, which is usually the case, we simply move on to other prospects. In the 54 years we've worked together, we have never foregone an attractive purchase because of the macro or political environment or the views of other people. In fact, these subjects never come up when we make decisions. It's vital, however, that we recognize the perimeter of our circle of competence and stay well inside it. Even then, we will make some mistakes, both with stocks and businesses." And he also said, "The goal of the non-professional should not be to pick winners. Neither he nor his helpers can do that, but should rather be to own a cross-section of businesses that in aggregate are bound to do well. A low-cost S&P 500 index fund will achieve this goal." That's the what of investing for the non-professional. The when is also important. The main danger is that the timid or beginning investor will enter the market at a time of extreme exuberance and then become disillusioned when paper losses occur. Remember the late Barton Biggs observation, a bull market is like sex. It feels best just before it ends. Yes, by the way, he literally has that in the shareholder letter. The antidote to that kind of mistiming is for an investor to accumulate shares over a long period and never to sell when the news is bad and stocks are well off their highs. Following those rules, the know-nothing investor who both diversifies and keeps his cost minimal is virtually certain to get satisfactory results. Those passages I just read are littered with incredibly insightful wisdom from the world's most successful investor. Of course, everything he says doesn't mean you need to do it, believe it, or follow it, but I do think it's smart to always hear and reflect on the perspective of successful people like that. I recommend re-watching this section and pause the video and listen to each sentence and see what takeaways you have. Let's move on. The number 10 reason I might sell a stock is if their fundamentals are deteriorating. This should be obvious, but if I'm seeing cash flows trending down, or revenue, or debt is increasing too quick, or things like that, then I might sell. If I see a trend break, I like to understand why and for how long and such. The number 11 reason why I might sell a stock is if it is insanely overpriced. For example, Tesla recently had a wild run-up. It went from 177 to something like 969 in less than a year. Now, some people still feel 900 is undervalued for it, but currently the market doesn't, as it has fallen back to around 540 as of the time I'm writing the script. And by the way, I'm long Tesla in my growth portfolio. Generally, I'm a buy and hold investor, but sometimes something can go so out of whack it's worth considering if you want to take your gains and invest elsewhere. There is an old saying that no one goes broke booking a profit. The number 12 reason I might sell a stock is if it is being acquired or is acquiring someone and I have big concerns about the process or the companies involved or the end vision post-acquisition. It's good to realize that many times what happens is that the company that is being acquired has a spike in its stock price that sometimes is short-term and sometimes lasts, and usually the company doing the acquiring has a dip, which again can be short-term or not. The number 13 reason might be if I felt the stock was unreasonably out of line relative to its competitors. So let's say all of its competitors are at a PE of 20 and it's running at a 50, I might look deeper to see why things have gotten out of whack. Careful on this one, as again, it's just a flag that would alert me to evaluate things and not automatically cause me to sell. That all being said, I think it's also useful to call out reasons not to sell. So number one, just because a stock has shot up doesn't mean I would sell it. The real factor to utilize is what I think the company's value is, not simply the stock price. I like to factor a ton of things into my stock purchases and sells, including things like my personal finances, the tax implications, etc. I know this sounds a bit counter to reason number 11, but my reasons to sell aren't binary decisions. There's a lot of nuance that goes into it. The number 2 reason not to sell is that oftentimes I see people selling their winners and holding onto their losers because human psychology helps them do the exact opposite of what they should be doing. They end up selling Amazon a year after it has gone up, but they hold onto their BlackBerry, aka Research in Motion, which got up to $144 in 2008 and is now under $4. You might remember them as the ones who once had the wildly popular BlackBerry smartphones and tablets. So it's sometimes a natural tendency to hold on to your losers. Again, this reason is nuanced when you take it into consideration with the previous reasons not to sell or reason number 11 to sell. Number 3, I don't sell solely because of price movement in the stock. I sometimes see people making buy or sell decisions based only on stock price changes rather than because of fundamentals, and I feel that's too risky to do. You shouldn't sell just because your stock goes up. It might have room to keep on running. Or conversely, some people sell in hopes they are avoiding the rug getting pulled out from underneath them as the stock falls. The reason why most retail investors in the market do so poorly is that they trade too much. Stocks and portfolios are like soap. The more you handle them, the smaller they often get. Number 4, I also generally don't sell purely for tax reasons such as tax loss harvesting. I think if you want to sell a stock, then that can be a good strategy, but I don't think it makes sense to sell losing positions to reduce your capital gains liabilities from other investments. That being said, this is also a nuanced one that might make financial sense for you to do that. Number 5, I also don't think it's good to sell a stock because you heard somewhere that the company is crap, like from your Aunt Jemima or your Uncle Harold or your coworker Carl. So I avoid taking any actions based on hot tips. Number 6, I don't think it's good to sell a stock based on trying to time the markets. Now is a great example. The market has fallen like a rock, and then it has shot up like a rocket. I don't play the time the market game, as no one in the world has consistently gotten it right. I know that to be true as we don't have any trillionaires yet. It's easy to think you could time the markets when you do it right for a few times, but no one has proven their ability to do it consistently. That being said, buying when something is a value still makes sense. Anyways, I want you to try to stay positive as we go through this insane volatility and this terrible pandemic. If you've been impacted by it in any way, then my heart goes out to you. If you'd like to chat with myself or other investors, then jump onto my Dividend Discord server that now has over 1,380 investors on it. Thanks, and stay safe, happy, and healthy, and I'll talk to you soon.
Remember, I'm not a financial advisor, and these videos are for entertainment, inspiration, and educational purposes only. Investing of any kind involves risk. I'm only sharing my opinion with no guarantee of gains or losses on investments. Don't use this information without double-checking it and talking to someone a lot smarter than me after you completely understand it. So I'll see you in the next video, and remember to stay positive, patient, play for the long term, keep investing in great companies, budget reasonably, and win. I know you can do it. Just like I know you can hit the subscribe, like, and bell icons, share this video with others, and comment below.